Those of you who are in the blasphemous religion of Christianity have pierced both of the Almighty's two anointed sons. His word tells us that the name that he gave to his only begotten son is the word of Elohim. This is recorded in the revelations of his only begotten son, chapter 19. Moreover this, his eyes were as a flame of fire, and upon his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that none knew except for his. You have not known his son's name because you have not been his son's brothers and sisters. Yeshua told us plainly that his brothers and his sisters are those of us that do his father's desire. This is recorded in Matthew chapter 12, verse 50. His father's desire is that we live by every word that the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel sent forth from his mouth, so that he will delight in us as he molds and fashions us in his image, in the image of Elohim. That which is written is referring to the word of Yehweh's mouth that he had recorded in the roll of his book and given to us. The name that is written that he gave to his only begotten son is written in the following verse: and he was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the word of Elohim. You have pierced the word of Elohim, and you have emptied it to the ground, and you have trampled his word under your dual feet. Therefore you have pierced his only begotten son, and you have trampled the word of Elohim's shed blood under your dual feet. You have followed behind a wolf in sheep's clothing named Saul of Tarsus that came to you in his own name, and you have let Saul's word trump the Most High's word that he spoke to us through his servants the prophets, including his only begotten son. And you have also pierced his second anointed son. Most of you do not even know that he has a second anointed son. You do not know this because you have emptied his word to the ground like refuse, and you have rendered it useless. You do not know about his second anointed son, even though the roll of his book is written upon his second anointed son. His word tells us that this son was going to be sent to us at this time, crying out, "Behold, I come at this time in the roll of the book that is written upon me." The last day of the year and the month and the day and the hour of the sixth trumpet would be on 4/14/2019 on his servant Satan's calendar if Yehweh was not going to shorten the hour of this period of time. This day is 2/27 on our Maker's Restored calendar. 2/27 is the day that he opened the ark's door for his servant and his family and the animals to be able to come off of the three tiers of this 300 cubit by 50 cubit by 13 cubit, by 30 cubit boat. 4/14 on his servant Satan's calendar parallels his Zechariah 4:14 prophecy. This verse tells us the following: "Then he said, These are two of the sons of the anointing oil that stand upon the master of all of the earth." The previous verses tell us who Yehweh is talking about. In verse 5 we are told, "The messenger that spoke to me answered and said to me, 'Do you not know who these two olive trees are?' And I said, 'No, master.' The messenger answered and spoke to me, saying, 'This is Yehweh's word that is upon Zerubbabel, saying, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit,'" referring to by his seven spirits, such Yehweh of hosts. "Who are you, great mountain? Before Zerubbabel's faces you will become a plain, and he will bring forth the headstone, Yeshua, shouting favor for favor unto him." This is not complicated. The question, "Who are these two olive trees?" is asked, and it is answered. The headstone is clearly referring to the Most High's only begotten son, Yeshua. Zerubbabel means one that flows out from Babylon. Therefore, it means one that flows out from Mystery Babylon at this time. And then after three verses that tell us more about this Zerubbabel's role in the here and the now, Zechariah again asks who these two olive trees are, and Yehweh's messenger again tells him. I will read this to you. Then I answered and said to him, "Who are these two olive trees that are upon the right side of the candlestick and upon the left side of it?" And I asked again and said to him, "Who are these two branches of the olive trees that are to the hand of the two golden spouts of the golden oil that pours out from these upon them?" in chapter 4, verse 5 of the revelations of his only begotten Son, Yehweh tells us that this golden oil is his seven spirits. Revelations chapter 5, verse 6 tells us that Yehweh's seven spirits are his seven eyes. His word only speaks of two people that his seven sets of dual eyes or his seven spirits are upon. Chapter 5, verse 6, other revelations of his only begotten Son tell us that Yeshua is one of them. And in verse 10 of this Zechariah chapter 4 prophecy that is in the roll of his book that is written upon this Zerubbabel, he tells us that this Zerubbabel is the other. Like I said, this is not complicated. And he answered me and said, "Do you not know who these are?" And I said, "No, master." Then he said, "These are two of the sons of the anointing oil that stand upon the master of all of the earth. The proof that you have emptied the word of Elohim out to the ground and you are trampling it under your dual feet that the Most High has set forth is found in the fact that you refuse to obey his voice in the very simple and straightforward charge for you to sustain his second anointed son at this time. He calls your failure to do so stealing from him, and he tells us that unless you cease from being thieves to him, he is going to curse you with the curses that he had recorded in the roll of the book that he has written upon me. If you had not emptied his ward, his house would not be empty at this time." Verse 14 is the last verse of chapter 4, and then he goes into chapter 5 where he tells us the following. "Then I turned back and lifted up my eye, and I looked and beheld a flying roll. And he said to me, 'What do you see?' And I said, 'I see a flying roll, and the length of it is 20 cubits, and the width of it is 10 cubits.'" These dual uses of this word for a roll are the last two of the 21 times that this word is used in the testimony of his word. The first of the 21 times that it is used is in Psalm chapter 40 prophecy, where he tells us that, "I'm going to say to you at this time, behold, I come in the roll of the book that is written upon me." His word is indeed written upon him sending me to you at this time. He has caused this 20 cubit by 10 cubit measurement to flow into his end time timeline and into the here and the now in an incredible way. "Then he said to me, 'This is the oath of the curse that will go forth upon the faces of all of the earth, because everyone that has stolen will be acquitted according to this flying roll, and everyone that has sevened," the next verse tells us that has seven to his name falsely, "will be acquitted according to this flying roll. It," the oath of the curse of this roll, "will go forth," says Yehweh of hosts, "and it will enter into the house of the thief and into the house of him that sevens to my name falsely, and it will continue in the midst of his house, and it will put an end to him that is among the timber and among the stones." Is it a coincidence that this admonishment about stealing from him follows him telling us that I am one of the two sons of the anointing oil that stand upon the master of all of the earth? You are going to be acquitted or not acquitted according to whether or not you will stop stealing from him and stop summoning to his name falsely. The following verses are a prophecy that is for his servant Zerubbabel's dual wives journeying forth with dual wings that are like the dual wings of a stork to build his house in the midst of Babylon, lifting up Yehweh's Maher-shalal-hash-baz ephah between his dual heavens and the earth. His Maher-shalal-hash-baz ephah also proves whether you believe his word or not. Concerning this ephah, he tells us the following in Isaiah chapter 8. It, referring to that which you are calling treason, which is referring to the previous verses that tell us that he is going to send forth Maher-shalal-hash-baz at this time, it will be for a sanctuary and for a stone and a plague and for a boulder and a stumbling block to the two houses of Israel and for a bird's net and for a hunter's trap to the inhabitants of Jerusalem. The two houses of Israel are Christianity and Judaism. He is orchestrating this in the manner that he is because he is making this about believing his word or not believing his word. His word must be our only measuring rod. His word tells us that all unbelievers are going to have your place in the lake that burns with fire and brimstone. His only begotten Son told us that all are going to be judged by his Father's word at this time. It is what it is. This sanctuary is referring to his house that is behind his 144 cubit tall wall. This stone is referring to the one stone and this one stone's holy seed that the Most High has sent forth to bring forth Maher. It is referring to the one stone who is the youngest of his flock, the last of his 144,000 first fruits. This boulder is referring to the boulder design of his house. This bird's net is referring to the net that he has sent forth to gather the brood or the set free bird of his Psalms chapter 84 prophecy, and this brood being gathered to her nest that she has found in Yehweh of Hosts altars. It is referring to this brood flying away upon the dual wings of a great eagle to this place for the appointed time, dual appointed times, at half of an appointed time, so that you can be fed and nourished with his unleavened bread of life. The hunter's trap is referring to Yehweh hunting those of you that refuse to turn back to him down and gathering these tares to throw you into the fire in order to be burnt up. He goes on in the next verse to add the following, and many of them will stumble and fall and be broken and be snared and captured. This is reality. This is a reality that you need to face, or else you're going to die in your rebellion to our Maker. This prophecy tells us that his bringing forth Maher in this manner is going to be a plague and a stumbling block as a result of your failure to believe his word in this matter, and your unbelief is going to result in your death. Before his only begotten son was pierced in the side, he told us the following. And then the righteous, those that sat at the king's right hand, per the previous verse, and then the righteous will answer him, saying, Master, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you to drink? When did we see you a stranger and gather to you, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and come to you? And the king will answer and say to them, Truly I say to you, in whatever you have done unto one that is the least of these my brethren, you have done it unto me. Yehweh's word calls me the least of his flock. He does so in his Jeremiah chapters 49 and 50 prophecies. Therefore, this is a prophecy for you not sustaining his second anointed son at this time. In not providing for the least of Yeshua's brothers, you have not provided for him. He said so. Yeshua went on to give us the flip side of this parable. And then he, the king, will say to them on the left hand, Depart from me, you cursed, into the everlasting fire that is prepared for the devil and his messengers. Yeshua went on to identify this group as those of you who did not provide for the one that is the least of his brothers. I do not think that you not providing for his anointed is going to work out very well for you in the coming days. In Matthew chapter 29, we are told that Yeshua said the following, If you want to be perfect, or if you want to be without blemish, go and sell that which you have and give it to the poor, and come and follow behind me. Come and follow behind the word of Elohim, and you will have treasure in the dual heavens. And these are the truths, aka Deuteronomy chapter 15, Yehweh identifies his second anointed son as being the one that he has sent to us at this time as a certain poor and needing one. He has done so as part of his judgment that is against you, and he links doing so to his seventh year Sabbath approaching. His seventh year Sabbath is indeed approaching. There are just 8 days that remain of the sixth year. And in Matthew chapter 5, verse 48, he tells us, You shall therefore be perfect, or you shall therefore be without blemish, in the manner that your Father that is in the dual heavens is perfect. This is not a suggestion. It is a commandment from the Most High and his only begotten Son. Yehweh not only spoke this commandment through his only begotten Son, he also spoke it through his dual servants that he has drawn out from the waters of the captivity, one of which is his second olive tree. Perhaps it is a coincidence that Turkey, who is one of the five nations that he is going to empower to bring you low, launched Operation Olive Branch in Syria, 11 days journey from the anniversary of the day that Yehweh caused his servant Noah to let loose the second dove that brought back the olive branch. 11 days journey parallels the 11 days journey from his holy mountain to the first entrance portal into the land of the promise. Our ancestors refused to trust and obey him at that time as well, and they were sentenced to die over the course of the following 38 years. Two of the 40 years of the second Exodus have passed, and we are in the remaining 38 years. Concerning his house being empty at this time, he tells us the following in Psalms chapter 137. Yehweh marked the children of Edom in the day of Jerusalem, who say, empty it unto the bottom of her. O daughter of Babylon, who is going to be ravaged, happy he will be who recompenses you with his recompense, as you have bestowed to us. Happy he will be who takes hold and dashes your little children into pieces in the rock. This verse 9 is amazing, because when I go out into the public to get supplies and such, I approach people that have little children in their shopping carts, and I plead with them, please, for your children's sake, look at the evidence. Please. But they won't do it. They just laugh in their hearts. It's amazing to see this. For their little children, right there in front of them, they still won't do it. They laugh at Yehweh's anointed. Happy he will be who takes hold and dashes your little children into pieces of the rock. The children of Edom is referring to those of you that have sold your birthright. It is referring to those of you that have traded your birthright that Yehweh gave to you to be his eternal heritage for that which is of the world and that which the world has to offer you. Empty it unto the bottom of her is referring to you piercing his second anointed son by not filling the depository of his house. It is also referring to you piercing his only begotten son by causing his word to fall to the ground. Therefore, it is referring to you trampling his only begotten son's shed blood under your dual feet. As you have bestowed to us is referring to according to that which you have failed to reward his house with. It is referring to your withholding your hand from his house and his anointed at this time. His house includes Maher-shalal-hash-baz's mother, who has Maher-shalal-hash-baz in her room. Therefore, it includes Maher-shalal-hash-baz. Perhaps it is a coincidence that Maher-shalal-hash-baz means to spoil you quickly or suddenly and to make haste to plunder you. Perhaps Yehweh did not mean it when he said that he is going to plunder you and spoil you before Maher's navel cord goes out from the Shulamite's womb. Or perhaps he does not lie, and he did say this, and he did mean it. I suggest that you believe his word, the same word that is written upon me and the here and the now, and turn back to doing what his word tells us we must do, or else you are going to die. You are going to die because you have pierced my two anointed sons, saith the Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel.